There is a podcast brewing that's about to take over podcasting for good. The only podcast that you are going to need to tune into day in, day out, is the Member Guest Podcast.
If I can hit it down the middle of the fairway, that's great. But again, with the driver right now, the driver sucks.
John Daly, and you're listening to the Member Guest Podcast. Rippin', rippin'.
Hello, hello, hello. Welcome to another episode of the Member Guest Podcast here in the studio, Jordan's Garage, with Jordan, Tony, and young Johnny joining us on tonight's episode.
Good evening.
What's How's everybody good? Doing?
Doing pretty well, man.
Bien, y tú?
We're trying to battle through the cold weather that we have here in Minnesota in January, and it's not ideal, but
dude, it's so brutal. Coming from Arizona yesterday where it was 65, coming back to -5 has been weird.
And happy birthday, by the way.
Yeah, Johnny, thank you, partner. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Love it,
my
man.
Fellas.
I think it's like -11 out right now or something.
Yeah, something like that.
What does it say?
It says -7.
And Jordan, you were just in California?
Yep, Los Angeles, La Jolla. It was good.
Yeah?
It was very warm there, 80 degrees, a little windy. I was a little upset because I was there and I didn't realize that the Farmers was going on. It was at Torrey. And I was just, right. I was literally 5 minutes away and didn't go. I had no clue.
Hmm. I don't know. Golf guy.
Yeah. Well, I was like watching. I was like, oh, it's at Torrey. I'm literally here. 5 minutes away from the course right
Golf
now.
Golf podcast host.
Yeah.
How did you bring your clubs?
Yeah, I went and played with Brandon.
Brandon,
the kid that played at Boston College and reached out to us, who's going to come on the pod.
Love it.
Yeah, he played D1 golf, and he's, I can't remember the name of the tour. It's the feeder tour for the DP World Tour. So he says he's playing in like Egypt and some stuff. It's like 4 months. So hopefully he comes on before that. Hooked him up with the Swannies guys. It was pretty unreal to play with him. Mm-hmm. Neither of us like knew what to expect, right? First time we met each other, super cool guy. I can't wait to have him on to talk golf, but like go out there. He made 9 birdies. We played 18 holes. He made 9 birdies. Had 2 bogeys. So he shot 7 under. He didn't miss a putt inside of 15 feet. Like, I kept up with him off the tee, even second shots in, but just the chipping and putting was what
Lights
completely,
out.
Yeah, it was night and day. It just unbelievable to watch.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah. We talked a little bit about, he's a big decade golf guy.
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
So that's why I asked you about that. So I started to put my numbers in and take a look at maybe applying that to my game.
Controversial figure in the world of golf.
Scott Fawcett?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I think most of the young college guys are in the decade.
Yeah, that's what he said. He said a lot of people, and especially for somebody like that, who it'll be interesting to talk to him about just kind of the grind of trying to make it, right? He's very self-aware. You know, he's like, I got 3, maybe 4 years to like move up, see if I can make it, and then if not, you know, go and do something else. But, you know, for him, like, he's paying his own way for travel, all the tournaments, you know, stuff like that. And so to have the decade golf stuff where you're going to a course that you don't know at all and you're just using, like, a local caddy, right, to get those numbers and it spit it out at you and, like, you have some kind of idea about where you're showing up to play.
Yeah,
I can see why people at that level would love those insights.
For the listeners, I think there's a guy named Scott Fawcett who started a company called Decade Golf, and his premise is that when you're hitting a golf shot, you are shooting a shotgun, not a sniper rifle. And basically the idea is, like, he provides, you track all your stats in this app. I don't want to butcher it, but like he provides there's a ton of golf courses on there that has satellite imaging maps that give you your specific like shot dispersion on every shot. So it will help you pick like what to aim at,
interesting,
what your target should be. So
huh.
I actually did it at Winsong before he had all the courses in there. And there was some interesting stuff, like, you know, different clubs to hit on different tees, you know, his big thing is like, you should hit driver if there's not a penalty area within a 60-yard wide area. So like,
well, I think it's based on your parameters, right? And the width of some people's dispersions is much, much wider
than
others. But even like PGA Tour pros, their dispersion is much, much wider than what most people would think. Yeah. And so the interesting part is just like some lines that you take. You may be aiming down a rough line.
Yeah, or at a bunker. Mm-hmm. Like, and it's like, well, that's the center of your shot pattern. Like, you know, hit it right at the bunker. You know, like and on one at Windsong, it might be like, you know, middle of the bunker mm-hmm. because like, you know, 40 yards left of that's out of bounds or, you know, whatever. I don't know. I mean, it's interesting.
Well, it was really funny too when I first downloaded, like, you watch all the videos and the first video had Will Zalatoris in it and he looks like he's 12 years old.
He's like one of the most biggest proponents of
yeah,
of
him and I think Bryson was the other guy. But like, I mean, he was probably still in college. I'm pretty sure he was still in college when he was doing this.
I mean, he started working with Scott Fawcett, I think, when he was like in like grade school, or not maybe not grade school, but like junior high or high school for sure.
Yeah. So wow. To wrap it up, I mean, it was fun to play with somebody at that level who's grinding to make it. I think he'll be a good guy to have on the episode and talk about kind of the grind if you really want to make it and what that takes.
Yeah.
And then again, the first thing that came to my mind. Andy was so like, we get up to the tee, right? And he was like, what do you want to play for? He's like, you want to do a, you know, 10-10-10 or whatever. I was like, let's play for merch.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, dude, I love that. So we ended up doing 10-10-10. And then he said he was going to use that to buy something for merch. But I was thinking about this, Andy. So he absolutely waxed me. And we were having the debate, you know, one of the last episodes about John Rahm's handicap. And how he's a plus 10, and could you beat him with the strokes at your home course? And with all due respect to Brandon, he's an amazing D1 college golfer trying to grind to make it on the tour. And he shot, you know, 7 under like it was absolutely nothing.
Wow.
I can't imagine what, like, John Rahm would do, right? Like, it just put into perspective how good,
isn't
like, the elite guys are. Dude. And I am now convinced that John Rahm would beat me by... he'd probably shoot 16 under at Windsong.
I mean, you think about some of the guys that all of us have been around or played with, and, you know, some of their handicaps are +4, even +5, something like that. And they're great college players. And then you think about John Rahm. I think the stat was that he was like a plus. If he was entering his scores into gin, his handicap would have been like +13.6 or something crazy.
Yeah, it's
just insane.
More than half of the course.
Think about the difference between a 0 and a 7, and that's how much better he is than a +5.
It's incredible.
Or zero. Yeah, and I think Brandon said he was a +5 from the tips, so I don't know what he is, like, you know, normally, but yeah. And Rahm's over twice as good as him, so he could probably shoot like 18 under the course we played. It's just nuts to think about. So
on the decade front, he does say, like, basically that he reverse engineered all of Tiger's shot length data and basically said that's, like, his system is basically, it's a little bit of a cheap way to sort of take credit for Tiger's career, like, after the fact. But he did say, like, you know, he reverse engineered it and found, like, there's crazy stats that I was trying to look up, but, like, about the percentage of time Tiger missed, like, fat side, like, basically never short sides himself. It's also, like, one interesting thing is, like, Tiger missed the green in his career 20% of the time from 100 yards out. That's, yeah, like, a mind-blowing fact. Like,
wow.
You would think you'd never miss.
Aiming is, like, really important, you know, even at 100 yards out or whatever. But, like, when he did, it was, like, almost always fat side. He was never short side. Like,
I've probably said this before, not on the pod, so I'll say it. But so when I was when I went out to Augusta and did the whole Masters thing, one of the executives from the company I was working with, they had a PGA pro come in and do like a thing with them and their customers. And they went out and played Colorado Golf Club where they have a membership. And I can't remember what pro was playing with them, but it was somebody like, you'd know the name. I can't remember it, so I'm not going to say it. But one of the things that the pro said when they were just like talking golf, he had a slide and it was Tiger at his peak. The number of greens and reg that he made in a round was the same as like a scratch golfer. Mm-hmm. It was like 13 out of 18 or 12 out of 18. But the percentage that Tiger got up and down at his peak was like 88 or 90 something percent.
Yeah.
And the scratch golfer was like 40%.
Have you ever heard his the Tiger's five golden rules of golf? It's
Can I see if I can guess it?
Yeah.
Because you have it up.
Go ahead.
No bogeys on par fives.
Yes.
No double bogeys.
Yes.
No missed putts inside of 3 feet.
No three putts.
No three
putts. Oh, no three putts. I don't know the other two.
No, so it's no three putts, no bogeys on par fives, no blown easy up and downs, no doubles, and no bogeys within 150 yards.
Oh, yeah.
And if you think about, like, all those things, like, they're not that hard. They don't seem that hard to do.
Yeah.
To do them consistently.
They don't seem that hard to do, but when you know that Tiger misses 2 out of 10 greens from, what did you say, 100?
Misses 1 out of 5 from 100 to 110 yards.
1 out of 5. So that means that even if your Tiger's, you're going to, and you better get that up and down, or there's your easy blown, bogey.
So before we get into the topic of the pod, I did have one tangent, which is anybody following what's going on with Grayson? Just like generally that
Grayson Murray or Grayson Apparel?
No, Grayson Apparel.
Yeah.
I follow them. Obviously, I follow them quite closely.
They're getting a little out there for me. I don't know. I wanted to dig in on this. Like, they threw a post up yesterday
on Instagram
about Sam Ryder. And it was like a picture of him, and the caption was "Spiritual Rider Sunday." Sam's journey to the final round at Torrey was paved by self-belief, a fearless pursuit to give direction to what lies ahead, keeping his head down, trusting the process, an underdog with the fire of a pack leader. This past week marked a special turning point that inspired us as a pack and has only fed Sam's desire to chase his dreams and keep growing along the way. Like, what's going on there? What's what is the Wolf fire pack of a pack leader? Can someone help me with that? And then on their website.
It's deep. It's deep, I tell you.
And then on their website, it's like they have all these, special memberships that you can pay a bunch of money to get, like, access to
different shirts.
Like, one of them is like the Black Wolf membership. Another one, which is $1,000.
I think JT has his own thing now, right?
Yeah,
on
it's
there
like
too.
The Crimson membership. Yeah, another one is called Spirit Wolf. Like, it's like $400.
And what does that literally gets you the opportunity to buy a different polo?
Yeah, totally. It's like access to limited edition product.
Yeah, so some of these brands and products do this really well, and some.
It's a little Adam Newman, like, trying to create, like, a cult following, Like, bro, are you in the Spirit Wolf? Like,
are you in the pack?
No, I'm Black Wolf membership.
I have the fire of a pack leader, man. Like, do you even have the fire of a pack leader? Like, I don't know. So I just wanted to talk about that for
That's
a minute.
That's pretty funny.
I keep don't know.
Seeing it, and I'm what like, your shirts are cool, but, like, I don't have the fire of a pack leader. Nor do I want the Spirit Wolf. I want to wear your shirt because it's cool.
I like your patterns. Yeah, well, I don't know what to say. I mean, I like their gear. So, hey, whatever they're doing, I like their gear.
Too.
So
I'm sure it's just the marketing team getting some more free reign.
They have
and
great
maybe,
stuff, like awesome stuff. But like,
I mean, all we know is that Sam Ryder has a spirit of a pack leader.
Yeah, he's got the spirit of a pack leader.
Like, I don't think you can have the spirit of a pack leader when you wear joggers like that. That was Sam Ryder, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yep. He had the joggers like up to his shins.
Do you not like joggers?
I mean, are you more of a Phil Mickelson fan? Because that's what
there were some epic comments on that. Someone was like, because he was like, I don't know how you can't wear shorts, but you can have joggers that are 4 inches. But like, they weren't 4 inches, they were like 2. And some guys were like, a lot of guys are like really happy with Phil's definition of 4 inches.
I didn't read any of those.
I didn't see that far. That's amazing.
No, I don't have anything against joggers. I'm just saying if you're going to be a leader of a pack, I feel like you can't wear joggers.
Yeah.
I mean, there is a certain body type that can wear joggers.
Or
the only one in this room that might be able to pull it off would be Johnny. Maybe.
I got two.
I
pairs.
Feel like Andy could be a joggers guy.
Well, it's like we all have thick lower halves.
We have wide bodies.
Remember guys podcast, dude, I ripped my pants at Sarah's holiday party.
I know. I saw the video.
So I just have this issue, man. Like I anyway, we're not going to talk about it on the podcast.
I would like to know, in the last 5 years, how many times have you gone to a wedding and ripped your pants?
Every single one except for one.
On purpose or accident?
And the one I didn't was the one I officiated a couple months ago, and it's because I brought a second pair of pants. So I like I proactively avoided the rip. So
That just goes to show you that Andy likes to have a good time at a wedding.
I mean, you got to pop lock and drop it, man. You know, if you're not.
Someone's got to do it.
Anyway, all right. So let's get into the topic. So we're talking about Bettinardi Golf. Both of two of our guys here at Member Guest Podcast recently had the full Bettinardi fitting experience. I think, Jordan, you were first.
Yeah, I'm looking at a couple of limited edition putters across the way here, and they are looking beautiful right now.
Yeah.
You want to get your putter on? You want to show it to the camera?
Yeah, sure.
Which one is it?
The purple and black one, I believe.
I think we could just take a picture of it and show it on the on the video.
Yeah, so, well, where do I start? I mean, Johnny, you can chime in at any point here, but one of the coolest golf experiences I've ever had. For those who don't know, so Bettinardi, they started out making putters. Actually, they just had their 25th anniversary because I saw they're doing like one putter, one limited run putter every week.
Is it 25 or 35?
I guess 25.
So it started in 1998. I thought it started in 1990.
Yeah, what I learned that I had no idea about previous to this is Bob Bettinardi basically discovered a way. Before, they were milling putters out of two separate pieces of steel, and the neck and the head were welded on together after that. Bob found a way to do it out of one piece, brought that to the industry, and kind of blew everyone away. And I had no idea he was making putters for Scotty Cameron for 8 years before he started his own deal. So I was pretty blown away by that. They, as we'll get to, the guys kind of like walk you around and show you around the showroom and some of the history and just the stories that they had and kind of the background on the brand that they gave us. I was blown away by
it. My apologies. It was founded in 1998, so I apologize.
Is that right? 25.
You were right.
25th anniversary.
Let's break this down from the beginning. So we'll start with you, Jordan. How did it come up? Who'd you go with?
Yes.
Did you know you were going to get a putter when you were going? Like,
no. Well, no. So this is the funny Jamie Rue story. Also, shout out Jamie Rue. His episode has set a Member Guest Podcast record for most views on YouTube.
Yeah, like four million.
And most listens on podcast. Like, 4 million minus 3,998,000.
Yeah, we're in the hundreds. We're in the hundreds, I think.
Yeah, it was a couple hundred listens and a couple hundred views on YouTube, which is...
got to start somewhere.
I mean, we knew that Jamie would be that guy, so...
Shout out the fans.
So we had kind of been talking about it because Jamie goes there all the time, right? And... he literally texted me one night and was like, hey, do you want to go to Bettinardi tomorrow? And I was like, yeah. Sure.
Which is in, just to be clear, Bettinardi's in Chicago.
Bettinardi's in Chicago.
We're
so
in Minneapolis.
Yeah, so we're doing like a day trip to Chicago. I get that invite and he goes, awesome. You know, we're getting on the, it was like 5:30, 6 o'clock in the morning, whatever. And I was like, cool. You know, what do you need from me? He's like, nothing. I was like, okay, well, at least let me drive you. Like, I pick you up, whatever. He's like, yeah, pick me up at the office and meet there at 5:30. So you get there at 5:30, park in the parking lot. Two cars show up. I did not know this at the time, but Justin Morneau gets out of his car. I was like, okay, I guess I'm bringing Justin Morneau and Jamie to the airport. And so it was Jamie, myself, and J-Mo. And we landed, went to Bettinardi, and on the way there, J-Mo is looking at his weather app, and he was like, it's going to be 80 today. Like, can we stay and play golf, too? And Jamie's like, yeah, it's Butler's last day. So he's like, Jordan, can you stay? And I'm just, you know, I'm like a kid in a candy store just trying to be, like, super cool in front of Justin Morneau. And Jamie's like, yeah, guys, I can stay. Like, yeah, it's cool.
It's whatever.
On the back. Yeah, yeah, it's whatever. Yeah. Yeah, it's cool. And on the back, and I'm, like, texting Sydney, and I'm like, hey, babe, like, I really need to stay here. My hands are shaking. Like, I'm playing Butler and going to Bettinardi doing
as
the whole thing.
As you're driving.
No, I wasn't driving. We were in a car. So we went to Bettinardi. Like, you walk in the front door, and they just treat you like family. I mean, everyone there is so cool. Went upstairs, and it was just, like, kind of one by one. You do the fitting experience, and they walk you through their process. And the thing I loved the most was it was about fitting a putter to your stroke and not like finding a putter and you kind of, you know, changing to how that putter is, right? Like they just started with the basics. Like, let's just look at your stroke. And then based off that, you know, I learned a lot of things about just putting in general. Tommy, who works there, is just so awesome at explaining things and making it like make sense in your head. I think if this means anybody or anything to anybody listening. So my Scotty that I had had a lie angle of 71, so a lot more upright, right? You know, more upright. And my the degree, the loft of my putter was like 3.5 degrees. And I ended up in something that was 66.
So a lot flatter, quite a bit flatter.
Yep. And 1 degree of loft.
Wow. And so, and that was just the putter that fit your stroke as is.
Yep. And it was an inch longer. Wow. Cause I guess I have long arms and I needed a longer putter for whatever reason. So it was 35 inch. And then after that, he was like, so here's the 5 putters that I would suggest based off of your stuff. Now it's all look and feel. And he put this one down there. So it's like the BB8C model. The DASS is something aged
double aged stainless steel.
Double aged stainless steel. Thank you, Johnny. And it's got the tour hive on there. So very similar to Scotty Cameron, how they have tour only, you know, circle T. Bettinardi has their, I think they call it the hive.
Yep.
Or tour, yeah, the hive. So you'll see a lot of their stuff with the the D on there.
And I'm looking at this putter, and I got to say, like, that's a bougie putter.
It is a bougie putter.
Gold, sick putter. Black that's shaft. So like, sick. Were you thinking at all in that point, like, if I get this putter, I'm going to have to cash everything? Because otherwise,
yeah, I mean, there
I'm
was a part of me
just get a lot of crap for it.
Yeah, there was a part of me that thought about that, but Jamie put it the best way possible, which was when you go get fitted. Like this is also a one of one, which is really cool. It's for me. Like it's not fit for anybody else. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not like you walk into a store and you pick up something and you make some changes. Like this thing was for me, which is super cool.
Yeah.
And yeah, so it's just a good memory of the. Of the day, the whole experience, all their stuff is made in the U.S., which is really cool as well. And I just like what they do from art, design, all their head covers, bags and stuff are really cool. Small tangent. They also have a, you have one of the NFTs, right?
Yep, I do.
So we were just talking about Grayson and kind of their, you know, the pack.
Spirit Wolf.
Yeah.
I'm a black member. Black Wolf member.
Yeah, but I'm Spirit Wolf. What are you?
Bettinardi's got what they call the Beekeepers Society. And so if you have an NFT, you get exclusive drops to, I mean, they do a lot of things. Like the two really cool things I saw this year were you can do a round at Stream Song if you have one of the NFTs and you can sign up for it. And there's like, I don't know, 40 spots or something like that. And you have to be an NFT holder. If you have one of their Circle T NFTs, which I have, only 25 out of the, I think, 1,000 people have the Circle T ones, and you get, like, exclusive events. So I wasn't a holder at the time, but they did, like, an event with, I think it was Kuchar, I believe, is a Bettinardi guy, and then Matt Fitzpatrick as well. So they do these really cool things for people that have the NFT. Like, I just think they've done a really good job with, you know, that kind of stuff that you're talking about, the exclusivity and kind of the hive and all the stuff they have. It's just awesome.
All joking aside, that's pretty dang cool.
Yeah, totally.
So like that's a different, that's a different level. That's pretty dang cool to be able to have some access to some of those kind of things. So to talk a little bit about the fitting itself, right? So you talked about, they're fitting it to your stroke. What is some of the technology that they were using when you were going through your fitting process?
Yeah, so they have the gosh, I can't remember what the
Quintec or
is it Quintec? Yeah,
Quintec is the one that takes yeah, I can't remember the number of photos, but it captures the ball rolling.
Yep, it captures the ball rolling, and so like you want all green, right? So it shows you like your the forward spin of the ball at impact, and like you know it takes these
how many skids it takes. And
yeah, all this stuff. So they have that. But then the one thing that they did that I haven't seen in a putter fitting before, and I've asked the guys at Second Swing about this, and they're like, yeah, it's a little more advanced. It just takes more time. But they basically do the, like, they take the images of the down the line, just like you'd be at a golf tech or something. So down the line and then from the side. And then they'll do kind of like when you're getting a lesson with a pro. I don't know if they do this with you, Johnny. I assume so, where they take the picture and they put in the lines with your hands. Mm-hmm. And that's how they get, like, the loft and the lie and really start to get you dialed into that.
All right. So anyway, so you're capturing, that's how that's finding out what loft you're going to be using on your putter. Is that's what you're saying?
No, the lie angle. Oh, lie right. Angle. So like, okay. If you're, you know, if your hands are really close in, right, like the lines are going to be like this. Yep. And your lie angle is going to be different than if they're out here and the lines are like this.
And did they coach you with your stroke at all? Or they
not at all.
Okay. So it's just like, you just rip it however you rip it.
No, I did that. And then they started to walk through, you know, the images, getting it to all green with the different lofts and lies. And then after that, that's when he said, okay, so, you know, the last kind of part is, are you straightforward, straight back? Are you more like toe hang, kind of have a curvature? Mine was more toe hang. And so that's when he started to talk about, you know, the different types of putters that are best for that style of stroke.
Like the different necks and all that
stuff. Yeah, different necks, toe hang putters, you know, Morneau got fit, and he was more straightforward, straight back, and so he got like a mallet style,
face balanced.
Yeah. So it's just like it was super cool to see all of that, and then they literally do your putter like right there. They do that. He's for got you too,
yeah, just the sick like club building station, yeah, right to the side of where they, dude, have it's the putting.
Like they do it right there.
Wow.
While you're doing your custom fitting experience.
Oh, this is great. Here's your spec sheet. Like,
we'll send it to you in four months.
No, they did it right there. It was unreal. Right there. Yeah, they had like another guy there working. And
that is pretty sick.
And then like people are coming in and out too. And Sam Bettinardi, I met both the Bettinardis. They were so cool. Sam Bettinardi came in and like shook everybody's hand and met everybody. And he was like, Tommy, I missed a couple of 3-footers the other day. I think I need to get my loft up a little half degree. And so they brought it in there and they did it and gave it back to him. And just like, it's so cool.
That's awesome. What did the fitting cost? Was it free with a putter?
Yeah, it was. I think it came with the putter.
Okay,
yeah.
Got it. We if don't you need go to probably get, go into that. But
I was just wondering, like, whether they.
Well, no, they have. So online, you can go schedule a custom fitting appointment, and go in there and get.
If you buy one, then
yeah, and you don't have to get like you can get just what you would at Second Swing. That's, you know, $200-$400.
Yeah, that's cool.
And then they also have, you know, higher end stuff that you can get, and then they got the stuff in the Hive that you're not supposed to talk about, but it's like a vault and it's all
no photos in there.
Yeah, no photo. It's really cool. Wow.
They do such a good, I mean, they're so hospitable, but I think to what you're saying, that's so cool. And this is like somewhat to be expected. The area is like a showroom, right? So they've got like so many cool products on display and everything's for sale. So, you know, you see something you love, you can get it. But
so if
I
we're playing the merch game there, it could get dangerous.
Dude. Oh, that would be the most dangerous
game. I will buy the Hive.
It would get, oh, you go in the Hive. It's the putters in there are so insane. Yeah, but
the Hive is really sweet.
It's sick because it's kind of like a hangout spot is the way it feels. And then the putting like evaluation and fitting area is kind of off to the side. But it seems like they'll only have a group in there like one at a time, right? So you're there with a couple buddies. No one else is going to come in there and just be messing around. So, of course, after we finish doing our experience, we're walking out the door and we've all got our arms full of gear and some other guys are coming up the stairs, like getting hyped to go in there. It's just cool. It's fun to share that with them. And then they just do such a good job of making you feel at home and comfortable. I mean, they've got food, snacks, drinks, all that. They're just like, what can we get for you? Kind of the service that you'd expect at these awesome courses that we've talked about previously too. So,
and Johnny, what did you walk out of there with?
So I was a little bit different in that I didn't go to get fit for a new putter. I found a putter when I was at Butler like a year and a half ago playing in the Invitational with my pops. I went in the shop and sometimes because Bettinardi's in Chicago, Butler will get some cool Bettinardi stuff in their shop to be expected. I found a BB0, which is one of their blades. And I was a mallet guy for the past 7 years. I found one of their blades that just has this awesome weight to it. And then it has this really springy honeycomb face. So comparative to my mallet that had a softer face, I could get the ball going without really having to feel like I needed to move it. Let the putter or the weight of the putter rather do some of the work. So I found that fell in love with it. I don't think I'll ever change it. So I just brought it out there to have them take a look at it, see, is this actually a good putter for me? The only thing they changed, I think, is he took maybe an inch and a half off of it. It was just a little bit long for me. And then he might have bent it like a degree, but I rolled it like three times. He's like, yeah, that thing's money for you. Don't change it. And so he adjusted it, got me set up with a new grip, and of course had to get some other goodies there. But
yeah, you got some other some other swag too. Didn't you get a bag?
Got the dirtiest McKenzie bag, dude. I'll have to post a picture of it. It's sick too, because they've got the patch on the back that says handmade by McKenzie, and it says for Bettinardi. And it's just like the nastiest. It's black and white camo. We'll see if we can throw up a picture, but then it's got the tour department logo stitched all over the place. And
oh, that sounds sick.
Cool. It's just, and I have a vessel kind of similar to Jordan's, and I'm trying to do some more walking, and that thing is just so heavy. So once I switched out to that thing, I was stoked. So
I mean, no matter what, you're gonna have that McKenzie bag for forever, probably.
I'll never forget that day. Like Jordan said, it's so special, and being able to share that with other people who are just as excited. Yeah. The other dudes that I went with, they all got fit for new putters, so they were just, you know, besides themselves. And yeah, they just do such a good job making you feel at home. And we were lucky enough to get shown around like the manufacturing floor a little bit, see a bunch of putters being milled. And something I was telling these guys when I first got here is, I think it was 7 or 8 months ago, they brought all of their leather good production in-house. So they're making head covers, scorecard holders, all of the above in-house. So that was really cool to see.
And they said they're going to a new location in Chicago, because now they're getting into wedges as well. They just came out with some wedges, which is pretty sweet. So they'll have putters and wedges.
Andy, as a couple of guys who use Bettinardi putters,
we got it.
We have to do this.
Yeah, Tony.
Do what? Yeah, should we? I mean, we might need to like hitchhike down to Chicago or something. But we got to do this,
dude. When do you want to go?
Yeah, well, he wants to go back. I mean,
I just want to go back to watch you guys do it, and then I can like, you know,
like kind of scared because I love my Bettinardi so much, but like I'm kind of scared.
No, bring it though.
That's just, well, I'm going just do to, what I did. Right? Evaluate.
Like, Oh my gosh, I just got the best idea. Dude, we should do a road trip vlog of this.
Dude, I'd be down.
How many hour drive?
6 hours.
6 hours.
That's not bad.
It's not bad.
It's be a long video, but.
Well.
It'll be a series.
It'll be five minutes.
6 hours depends on who's driving.
Yeah, but, right. Yeah, we could leave super early, get there, do lunch, and do that whole thing, and be back. We could do a day trip. I'll drive.
All right.
Let's in my go. Truck.
Doing it. Sounds like love a brand it. I know.
Great idea. We're gonna do it.
I'll reach out to Tommy, and we can find a day.
Done. We'll do it on a weekend. Dude. It'll be awesome, because you know, those of us that labor away at work can't, you know, yeah, that kind of thing. So
we
anyway,
to Saturday.
Bettinardi, great company.
Not sponsored, by the way. Not yet. This is not a.
They're just awesome. What they do. Awesome.
And we all just like happen to play their putters because we think they're the best putters.
Yeah. Totally. And to wrap up the episode, I was getting adjusted today by my chiropractor. He's like, yeah, man, I listened to a couple episodes of the pod. And I was like, all right, which ones did you like and which one sucked? He was like, I didn't think any sucked. I listened to the Chad one. And then you guys did some like draft thing.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, oh, yeah, the brands draft. He's like, I kind of like that. I actually listened, or I found out a lot of golf brands that I didn't know about. And then he mentioned Bettinardi, which was like, to me, it's just funny that people that actually golf and are he's a member at Oak Ridge. He hadn't even heard of Bettinardi and like some of these brands talked about.
We are building Bettinardi up.
For sure.
You know what I
for
mean?
For sure.
Like, I don't know what they'd do without us.
Me neither.
I don't know if I go that far, but you're right. I mean, it's funny how many people you'll meet that haven't heard of it before. Because to us, it seems like it would be a given. But yeah, we're lucky to be around it and have these beautiful wands. They're pretty special. Yeah,
I'm excited to play. Well, so I'll reach out to Tommy. We'll schedule. We'll do like a vlog pod. That would be super fun. Do
some stuff 100%. With the truck.
You guys will just have to deal with me driving for 12 hours, but we'll get it done and go out there and
figure it out. That sounds awesome.
Everybody, thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time.
All right. See you guys.
Peace.